Okay, let's start. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome at the Yards presentation of HITEPS, and we would like to go deeper into the power quality, arc flash, and harmonic simulations. Okay, so again, welcome at the presentation of Yarting. Maybe a short introduction of HITEPS. This is our office in Gemert. We're working from Gemert with our engineers from this office already 3 years, working already with 18 employees. Over the 10 years, 13 years that we exist, we developed our skills, but also products and services over the years just to support you even more than we already did. We work for like 50 of the 100 top 100 companies in the Netherlands and try to improve ourselves continuously. In 2013, the connection with the University of Eindhoven grew, and this is also the reason that Professor Kobbe is joining us today and giving you more insights in harmonics on weak grids. We do work all over the world, so wherever customers need us, we fly to. At the moment, it's a little bit difficult with COVID, of course, but we always try to find the right solutions to get wherever we need to go. Customers that we serve, widespread from industry to data centers and everything in between. In the yachting and offshore business, we have quite some experience over the last 10, 12 years, and also experience different problems and issues on weak grids. And I will explain a little bit more on that during my presentation. As a HITEPS, we can provide you monitoring services, trainings, measurements, and simulations. And after concluding the power quality results, we can also provide you with solutions, customized or standard solutions for your problems. Today, Professor Kobbe will give you a presentation on weak networks, and Vera Verbakel will introduce arc flash calculations in onboard of yachts to you, and myself, Christian van Dorst, will introduce you in cases and also simulations of harmonics on vessels. So enjoy the 45 minutes. After the session, we have 5-10 minutes to ask questions. If anybody has questions during the session, please let us know in the chat, and we will try to respond accordingly. Okay, now let's see if this works. Yep, there we go. Okay, so power quality. Basically, power quality is the quality of the voltage and the current in the grid. And on strong grids, on land installations, the effect of harmonic currents is a little bit less. And in weak grids, like for example on yachts, the effect of harmonic currents is a little bit higher on the voltage quality. Concluding, you will experience sooner, faster power quality problems onboard on yachts, on offshore installations than you do in land installations. Professor Kobbe will go deeper into these phenomena. Okay, what are the consequences of poor power quality? Over the years, we've been experiencing a lot of things. For example, flickering of lights. The flickering of lights, especially on luxury yachts, is pretty irritating. Somebody buys a very nice vessel, and the first thing that he sees is the flickering lights. We see a lot of problems with that. Apart from that, also auxiliary equipment fails, for example, UPS systems and even cooking devices. I will give some more insights on the UPS system problems in this presentation. Another thing is overloading of generators and switchgear. So you can also turn it around and say, hey, can I use less generator capacity, or can I run with one generator instead of two when I have no harmonics or when I compensate my reactive power in the grid? Disturbances in accuracy of measuring and security systems. For example, when synchronizing generators with shore or between each other, you could find some problems with that. And overall, a shortened lifetime of electrical equipment. And how shortened it is, well, it's hard to say, but it is proven that equipment will last less long on a very distorted grid. Well, of course, the increased temperature in cables, transformer and distributors, which can even cause fire. And on that last point, I would like to take you on a business case that we experienced. The complaint of the customer here was that he had flickering lights. If you can see in the video, this is on deck of a yard. You see the flickering. And this flickering really occurred when there was a very high harmonic distortion in the voltage. Apart from this, also the power supplying transformers of the lights, they got too hot, in the end resulting in a fire between the ceiling and the top of the deck, let's say. And there were no fire detection systems installed in this area, so meaning that there was a fire on top of the ceiling and nobody really detected it. Luckily, the engineer was he saw it on time, preventing more failure, more damage on that vessel. We started measuring, and we saw that here you see that the THDU value of 2%. THDU stands for total harmonic distortion. And the high THDU value is 8%. That is, well, a very high distorted voltage in this case. And over the time here, you see that we've added more distorting loads to the grid. And we added the HVAC systems, we added the stabilizer system, the bow thrusters, to reach a higher THDU. During these measurements, we started also to measure the temperature of the transformer. And as you can see here, that the temperature increased when the THDU in the voltage also increased. So meaning there was a direct relation between harmonic distortion and also the increasing temperature in these transformers. Measuring in real time with power quality and analyzers, we see that the THDU, the voltage distortion, is about 9 to 10% in this area. Lloyd says, okay, you need to reduce your harmonic distortion in the voltage to a value below 8%. This value here is way above the Lloyd's limit. A case that happened on board of a vessel is also the UPS failures, let's say. In this case, due to a high distorted THDU, the high distorted voltage, like you see here. You see here the voltage waveform that is also very rippling. It's not a sine wave anymore. These UPS systems reacted on this distorted voltage, and they did what they had to do. They went to battery mode. But basically, there was a voltage provided to the UPS system, and the battery went to battery mode continuously, meaning that when the batteries were empty, the complete installation behind the UPS is still failed. The cause of this was a double zero crossing here in the voltage waveform. You could see in this picture very clearly that the voltage waveform has a double zero crossing, like you see here, and meaning that the UPS system detects a failure in the grid voltage and says, okay, I go to safe mode. But when it never charges again, well, then basically the UPS is useless, because it will fail after 30 minutes, 1 hour, resulting in this case in a complete media installation that failed. If we look to the vessels nowadays, we see more and more electrical propulsions. In this case, the customer builds a ship, let's say, a vessel with electrical propulsion. And the ship is about 30, 35 years old. The existing AC-DC converters that were used to control the speed of the propellers was there for a long time, and the whole installation worked fine. But on a certain moment, the engineers replaced the AC-DC drive for an AC-AC drive on one of the thrusters, in this case on the bow thruster. After some months, they experienced a fire inside the controls of the AC-AC drive. After replacing, another fire occurred, and then they start to think, "Hey, what's going on here? This is not normal." When we looked into into that situation, we found out that the voltage distortion was huge. It was almost 30% THDU. And if you look at the pictures before, the Lloyd's limit is 8%. Normally on vessels, you measure sometimes 9 or 10 or 11%, but 30% is very high. If you look at the sine wave of that voltage waveform here on the left side, you also see these notches that that really go into the voltage quality here, and also causing multiple zero crossings here on the on the zero crossing line. Looking into solutions for this case is, well, it's not a simple thing to do. The moment we're looking into the usage of passive harmonic filters here on the AC-DC drives, but normally we also use active harmonic filters to solve this kind of issues. Brings me to the active harmonic filters, and an active harmonic filter is basically a system that continuously measures the quality of the current and tries to compensate the harmonic distortion present in this current. And by compensating this harmonic current, you can also improve the voltage in the end. But the following presentation will explain you more about that. So active harmonic filters are a very efficient and flexible tool to use when you experience harmonic distortion problems. Apart from the harmonic distortion problems, the active filters can also be used for unbalanced issues. For example, if you have L1, L2, L3 on a vessel, on a generator, and you load L1 with a very high value and L2 and L3 are less loaded, the active filter can balance these currents. So the generator can be used more efficient than when there is an unbalanced system. So a lot of, let's say, good things about the active filter. In this picture, you see here the active harmonic filter switched on, the THDU value of around 2.5 to 3%. When we switch off the active filter, the values go up to 7.5%. And this is indeed the instantaneous moment. So switching on the active filter results directly in an improvement of the THDU. Well, in the end, we would like to reduce, of course, the breakdown of sensitive equipment, overloading of that installation, sometimes also saving fuel, and make the whole vessel a safe environment again, where you can rely on the installation. Some of you already implemented the HiTEPS active harmonic filters. And I think, the proof is there that the filters do their job as correctly as they can. Looking at the harmonic distortion model, then you can also ask yourself the question, okay, I can build a vessel and compensate harmonics afterwards, but is there also a way to get an indication of the harmonic distortion that I can expect before I'm going to start building a vessel? Now, and that is, to answer this question, we started to do modeling of ship installations, and we tried to do and simulation. We generated a simulation model to see if we can predict the harmonic distortion on the vessel before the vessel has been built. We do that with in compliance with the electrical installer. Try to gather all the data from all electrical equipment, put that in our model, and with the measurements that we do during the sea trials, we try to improve that model continuously. So we have a PDCA, plan, do, check, act continuously to improve the models. It has also been used to determine the sizes that is needed for active harmonic filters to be within the Lloyd's limits. So on different scenarios that you can have, for example, one generator or two generators or three generators in a hot environment or in a cold environment, we can determine these different loads and provide you with the correct data of the harmonic distortions in each scenario, like you see here on the right. Apart from that, we can determine the size needed for an active harmonic filter or another solution to be within the limits or to be within the customer specs, because the customer specs are sometimes lower than the Lloyd's limits itself. To give you an example, this is one vessel we defined in the simulation software. And as you can see here, we have four generators supplying the main grid. Apart from this, it's also a hybrid vessel. So there's also a shaft generator located on the shaft of the vessel. And this shaft generator can also be used as a motor. So it can also be a sort of turbo for propulsion. Well, a lot of converters, a lot of drives in this installation. So the expected harmonic distortion is pretty high. As you can see here in the modeling, you do see that the THDU in the voltage is around 8.5 to 8.7% in the very high loading conditions. And for each condition, we summarize the results in these tables. Of course, a lot of calculations.
Christian, I don't hear you anymore.
Hello. Yeah, nu hoor ik je weer.
Ah, good. I don't know what happened there, but I was out.
Okay. No problem.
So, last sheet. So, the summary: harmonic distortion in the voltage, the compensation needed in the current, and on the right side, you can see here the harmonic spectrum that is expected to be the result after the compensation. So, we discussed the problems that could occur on a vessel. We discussed a possible solution that could be implemented on the vessel, and at forend that we can predict the harmonic distortion in the voltage by doing simulations. I would like to end my presentation with this sheet, and would like to give the word to Chef, who will take you into the insights of weak grids on board of.
Yes, I hope that the sound is good. Welcome, everybody. Good afternoon, or good morning, or good evening, people who are in another time zone. So my presentation is about weak networks, and try to explain why the power quality at ships or at weak networks in general is a topic that should be studied, analyzed, and analyzed. The weak networks you can find principally in all installations who are not connected to the public network, so offshore applications, ships, fairs, emergency generators, microgrids, where you look to the future and you have the networks with storage, solar systems, wind parks. They could also be disconnected from the public network and operate as a microgrid. And all of these have the problem that the impedance of the network is quite high. So when you have a weak network, the major problem is that the impedance of the system is high. Normally, when you have public network and you are connected with the European network, let's say, then the short circuit power is quite high. And then we say there's a strong network because the when you take the short circuit power and you divide it by the nominal power of your installation, then you mostly are above 100 or at least between 20 and 100. But when you are connected to a generator with a high impedance, and a high impedance also results in a low short circuit power, then this value is mostly below 20, 10, 5 times maybe. And that means that you have a weak network. It also means that you have, when you have a distorted current, so there is some harmonics in the current, that the impact on the voltage will also be quite high, because this harmonic current will flow in the high impedance and will result in a high distortion here at the bus bar. Let's explain that also with an example. So in this example, we have a connection with the public network. So this black box means that the switch is closed. Now we have a connection with the load, and the load is a source of distortion. Let's say it's a 6-pulse bridge. It mostly gives you 5th and 7th and 11th and 13th harmonic distortion. There's a general load also connected with a certain apparent power and certain power factor, a bit low. That's the reason why we also have a capacitor bank, which now is not connected, but we could connect it to the installation to improve the power factor. When we look to the current, what is flowing to the 6-pulse bridge, then we see that in this current, we have some distortion. So it's not a real nice sinusoidal waveform, but distorted current, what is quite normal for a 6-pulse bridge, with 5th harmonic, 7th harmonic, 11th harmonic, and 13th harmonic current. So that's the spectrum of the current. And when we look to the impact on the voltage, then we can see that the impact on the voltage is quite low. Also, the harmonic voltages is 5th and 7th, 11th and 13th harmonic. All of them are below 1%. So in principle, the impact from this distorted current on the voltage is low, and that's due to the fact that the impedance of the network is also quite low. So when we look to the impedance of the network and we look to the frequency domain, so the 20 here means that we have 20 times the fundamental frequency, 20 times 50 hertz, or maybe for some people 60 hertz. It means that we are here around 1 kilohertz, 2 kilohertz, 3 kilohertz. And the impedance, total impedance of the system is of course growing due to the fact that we have an inductance, and the impedance of this system will increase with frequency. And also the resistance will increase a little bit with frequency, but mostly it's the inductance and the total impedance of the system that will grow with increasing frequency. But still, even with higher frequencies, the value of the impedance is still below one. When we go to the system where we are connected with the generator, so we close this switch and we connect the generator with the load and also with the source of distortion, and we open the switch to the public network. So then we have the situation that we are connected to the weak network, the high impedance. And when we compare the impedance of the generator with the impedance of the network, then we see that this impedance is much higher. So for, let's say, the frequencies here around 1 kilohertz, 2 kilohertz, is around 10 times higher than the impedance of the network itself. And 10 times higher impedance also means that the distortion in the voltage is 10 times higher. But it's also the impact, the current on the voltage is 10 times higher. That means that we now facing a voltage distortion of around 10% fifth harmonic, 10% seventh harmonic, 11th harmonic, and 13th harmonic, is around 7-8%. There's a huge distortion in the voltage due to the fact that we are now connected to the weak network. Let's go back to the situation where we are connected to the public network. So this is closed again. And now we also switch on the capacitor bank. So we try to improve the power factor here, the load, by switching on this capacitor bank. And let's see what the result will be. First, there's of course an impact on the impedance, because the impedance of the capacitor, with increasing frequency, the impedance of the capacitor will decrease. At a certain moment, because we have an inductance and we have a capacitor, at a certain moment the impedance of the capacitor and the impedance of the inductance will be the same. That's the moment that we have a resonance in the system. And the resonance here, where we get this jump in impedance, is around the ninth harmonic, so 450 hertz. Let's see what the impact is on the voltage. The impact on the voltage is still limited. Of course, we see a little bit of an increase in the seventh harmonic, because that's close to the ninth, where we have this resonance frequency. But because the fact that we don't have a ninth harmonic current, the impact on the voltage is quite low. But assume that we have installed a capacitor bank with a bit more capacity, then the resonance frequency will decrease. And it could be that we should have a resonance around the seventh harmonic. And when we have a resonance around the seventh harmonic, where we also inject the harmonic current, then the impact on the voltage, even when we are connected to the strong network, is quite high. So the total harmonic distortion here is more than 8%. So above the limit, because the limit for total harmonic distortion is 8%. Even when you are connected to the public network, you could face some problems with harmonics when you are in a situation of a certain resonance. This will also affect the capacitor, because in the capacitor there will be a huge current flow for this seventh harmonic current. And we see here the fundamental current, but we also see this component of the seventh harmonic. Counting all these tops, you can see that it is seven times higher frequency than the fundamental frequency. And we all see that the current flow is quite high. And that's the reason of that is that for the capacitor, the impedance of the capacitor will be seven times lower than normally the impedance of the 50 hertz. And then also the current flow in the capacitor will be quite high, perhaps also damaging the capacitor bank. When we look to the same situation, but then we are connected to the generator, so we open the switch, open the connection with the public network, we connect the generator to the system where also the capacitor bank is connected. Then we get this for the impedance of the system, and we get a resonance around the third harmonic. And because of the fact that we don't inject third harmonic current, then the impact of the voltage will be low. And because of the fact that also the impedance of the system is reduced, because we switch on this capacitor bank, we see that the impact of the harmonic distortion of the current on the voltage is limited. So in this case, the capacitor bank is helping us a bit. So there's a weak network and the impact on the harmonic. Besides the impact on harmonics, there are also other phenomena. Another power quality phenomena is fast voltage variations, what could result also in flickering of light. And voltage variations will arise when you have current variations, and starting of a motor is one of the sources of current variation. And when we start this motor and you have a certain inrush current, what could be when we have a direct start, 5-6 times the nominal current, and you will also have a voltage variation at this bus bar. When we are connected to the public network, again, strong network, low impedance, then this voltage variation will be limited. So in this case, the voltage will go down up to 0.94 per unit, so the nominal value. So there's a limited variation in the voltage. Here we can see the current. The current is flowing up to 3 times, almost 4 times the nominal value. Then we get this voltage variation. But when we are connected to one generator, then this voltage variation due to the inrush current of the motor will be much higher than the minimal voltage, will be around 0.86 of the nominal voltage. So the weak network also will give you a more voltage variation. Another problem is notches. Christian already showed in his presentation the effect of these notches. And they occur because the fact that you have this 6-pulse bridge. The DC connected here will be charged by using this voltages, the line voltages. And here we start with line voltages between phase 1 and 3. But that means that we are working in this circuit 1 and going back to 3. So this diode is conducting, this diode is conducting. And when we switch over to phase 2, 3, then this diode will start conducting and then going back in the same diode here. But there is a short moment where both of these diodes are conducting. That means that you have a short circuit here. And the short circuit will flow. And then weak network, the short circuit will be a little bit limited due to the fact that there's a high impedance here. But also the impact of the current that is flowing on the voltage will be quite high because of the high impedance. But that's the reason that you get these notches on every moment that you go from one voltage to another. So the challenge is to design an installation in a way that you can stay below the limits of the standard. And the standard, of course, is different for a public network as for ships. And that means that for fast voltage variations, the limits are much wider, so plus 20 and minus 20% compared with the voltage variation what is acceptable in a public network. But on the other hand, and that's maybe the biggest challenge there, when you look to the total harmonic distortion, what is acceptable for a public network and what is acceptable on a ship, and you see that even the value on a ship is more stricter than the value on a public network. But on the other hand, it is much more difficult to achieve it because the network is weaker. So this is quite a big challenge to keep this total harmonic distortion below the 5%. So to give an overview of the problems and the solutions, so this harmonic voltage distortion is a challenge, also to keep it below the limits. And too high voltage distortion will give you malfunctioning of equipment. The harmonic current distortion, resulting in this harmonic voltage distortion, but on its own also resulting in overloading of components and reduced lifetime of components. Due to the fact that you have harmonic currents and harmonic voltages, there will also be more reactive power, not only due to the phase shift between voltage and current, the fundamental voltage and current, but also due to the harmonics. And high voltage and frequency variations due to the weak network. Solutions to solve these problems are improving the equipment. So choose the equipment in a way that you have lower current variation, lower inrush currents, less distortion in the harmonics. Soft starters could help with lowering this inrush currents. But other mitigation devices also for the harmonics are active and passive filters. And the possibility is also increasing the short circuit power of the system. What could be done to adding a second generator, starting the second generator, that will double the short circuit power, but of course that will also introduce new loss. So that's the presentation from my side. Thank you for watching. And when you have questions, I shall try to answer them. Then I think I will give the floor to Vera.
Thank you, Chef. A good day, everybody. I will tell you something about the arc flash risks. I'm going to share my screen with you. Just a second, please. Okay, I hope you can all see. Yes, something about arc flash calculations. Let's first start with explaining what an arc flash is. It's a sustained electrical arc that can result from switching or failure within an installation. What can cause an arc? Unfortunately, most of the times due to failure in people's work on, for example, distribution boards. But it can also be caused by vermin, decayed or lacking insulation material, bad joints, and incorrectly sized switch gear. Well, the characteristics of an arc are extreme temperatures, above 19,000 degrees of Celsius, flying fragments of the insulation, so heated or melted parts, a big pressure wave with a deafening bang, and an intense bright light with both visible and invisible spectrum, and released copper gases. So the risks are big. So you can get external burns, injury, or temporary or permanent blindness or hearing damage, and also copper poisoning and internal burns due to inhaled ionized gases. Well, how can we ensure the safety? We start by research your electrical installation. Then we can make a simulation of the electrical installation. When we have done that, there will be a conclusion with a final report, and the output will be that we have an you have an insight into your electrical installation, and we have arc flash labels which clearly show the right protective equipment to wear. Unfortunately, next to personal injury, there are other consequences to the business continuity. I do speak about business, but this is also for yachts. For example, if you have an arc flash and you have damage to the electrical installation, you also need replacement or repair to the installation parts, and you have loss of time. So you do not have decrease in production capacity, but you do have the problem with continuing your trip or whatever you are doing on your ship or yacht. And of course, you have financial damage. This picture was also shown by Kristan. It's pretty much the same. So we start with the single line diagram. We gather some extra data so we can make a simulation. Then by simulating, we get some results. We put them in a final report, and you will get also the arc flash labels. This is an example of a label. So this label shows you some important parts or you need to know. So for example, you immediately get to see short circuit current. You get to see the arc energy that will be released by the arc. You can see the classification. This is an example of a European label. We can also, as you saw on the next picture, that we can work by American standards. You can see the working distance, and every label has a unique ISO number. This is the way we can calculate the simulation of ArcFlash. So we can work by American standards, and we can work by European standards. IEEE, you will see that later on in the presentation. I will come back to that because this is typical for American standards. This is what I was talking about. This is a part of the rules and regulations for the classification of ships from Lloyd's Register. And there you see mentioned that, for example, you can use a standard like the American standard, but it's also a possibility that you use, for example, European standards. What you further see in this part of the rules and regulations are that the points you need to be aware of and what has to be calculated and which risks has to be mapped out in advance. So this is an interesting part and there is a lot of attention to. This is an example of a final report you will receive. And of course, the labels I just show you. Here we have a number of clients who already have some calculations and simulations done by HITEPS. Why would you do some ArcFlash calculations and why should you let them be made by HITEPS? It's because if you want to guarantee the safety of your employees or the people who are on board of your yacht. You increase your business continuity. You comply with the current rules and regulations, for example, Lloyd's Register. And you have an up-to-date insight into your electrical installation. The HITEPS team also has the right knowledge, experience, and professionalism and brand independence. So that's also very nice. It does not make any difference for us. Then some final questions for you. Do you have a complete overview of your electrical installation? Is your data known and mapped out? Do you know where possible risky situations can arise? But do your employees or people on board know this too? This was my presentation about the ArcFlash on yachts. If you do have any questions, feel free to ask. And I also want to thank you for listening and attending to this webinar. Also, regarding to the other discussed topics, feel free to send us an email if you are not able to ask your questions and if we do not have enough time to answer them right now.